when he was already America's most wanted criminal. He reportedly spent 2 weeks in the American hospital in Dubai, was treated by an American doctor, and visited by the local CIA agent.
We have not seen one piece of evidence that links Osama bin Laden directly to the planning stages of September 11th.
This failure to provide proof was later said to be unnecessary because bin Laden, in a video allegedly found in Afghanistan, admitted responsibility for the attacks. This confession is now widely cited as proof. But the man in this video has darker skin, fuller cheeks, and a broader nose than the Osama bin Laden of all other videos. We again seem to have planted evidence.
In 1976, Osama's older brother Salim bin Laden hired a man in Texas by the name of Jim Bath to handle all the investments in the United States for the bin Laden family. Jim Bath also happens to be a personal, almost lifelong friend and former Air National Guard pilot with George W. Bush. The connections between the Bushes and the bin Ladens become much more clear when George Herbert Walker Bush made trips to Saudi Arabia in 1998 and 2000 to meet with the bin Laden family on behalf of a company called the Carlyle Group.
How could anyone fly a 60-ton, 125-foot-wide, 44-foot-tall plane through this obstacle course?
The aircraft, before striking the Pentagon, reportedly executed a 270-degree downward spiral. And yet Hani Hanyur was known as a terrible pilot who could not safely fly even a small plane.
No seats, no luggage, no bodies. Nothing but bricks and limestone.
The official explanation is that the intense heat from the jet fuel vaporized the entire plane. Flight 77 had two Rolls-Royce engines made of steel and titanium alloy and weighed 6 tons each. It is scientifically impossible that 12 tons of steel and titanium was vaporized by jet fuel.
We're also told that the bodies were able to be identified either by their fingerprints or by the DNA. So what kind of fire can vaporize aluminum and tempered steel and yet leave human bodies intact?
From my close-up inspection, there's no evidence of a plane having crashed anywhere near the Pentagon. And as I said, the only pieces left that you can see are small enough that you could pick up in your hand.
Shortly after the strike, government agents picked up debris and carried it off. The entire lawn was covered with dirt and gravel so that any remaining forensic evidence was literally covered up. The videos from security cameras, which would show what really hit the Pentagon, were immediately confiscated by agents of the FBI, and the Department of Justice has to this day refused to release them. If these videos would prove that the Pentagon was really hit by a 757, most of us would assume the government would release them.
It looks like there's nothing there except for a hole in the ground.
Basically, that's right. The only thing you could see from where we were was a big gouge in the earth and some broken trees. We could see some people working, walking around in the area, but from where we could see, there wasn't much left.
Any large pieces of debris at all?
No, there was nothing that you could distinguish that a plane had crashed there.
Pancake theory. according to which the fires, while not melting the steel, heated it up sufficiently to cause the floors weakened by the airplane strikes to break loose from the steel columns. And this started a chain reaction.
So you would expect then from that theory, which is the official theory, to see a whole stack of floors piled up on top of each other and then a spindle of core columns standing too.
The core of each of the twin towers consisted of 47 massive steel columns. If the floors had broken loose from them, these columns would have still been sticking up into the air 1,000 feet.
The plane did not cut all those core columns.
We designed the buildings to take the impact of the Boeing 707 hitting the building at any location.
The building probably could sustain multiple impacts of jetliners.
That the plane flew straight into the building. So you're saying that the building was actually designed to cope with a hole like that and
right.
then still survive?
Yeah, it was.
If you had dropped, say, a billiard ball from the top of the World Trade Center, 110 floors up there, it would have taken 8 to 10 seconds to hit the ground, encountering no resistance whatsoever.
The Twin Towers came down in nearly free-fall speed. 200,000 tons of steel shatters and explodes outwards over 500 feet.
This means that floors shattered at an average rate of about 10 floors per second.
There is no scenario for a pancake effect of buildings falling that allows them to fall at the rate of free fall.
Now what can do that? What can move mass out of the way? Explosives. Forty-seven huge steel columns going up the core. They're interconnected. How do you get them to fail simultaneously so the core disappeared? It looks like those core columns were cut.
The way we do this is by cutting the beam at an angle.
I started looking at the molten metal. All three buildings, both towers in the rubble, in the basement areas, and building 7, there's these pools of molten metal.
You'd get down below and you'd see molten steel. Molten steel running down the channel rails. Like you're in a foundry.
The molten steel was found 3, 4, and 5 weeks later, when the rubble was being removed. He said that molten steel was also found underneath World Trade Center 7.
So I'm looking through the official reports. What do they say about the molten metal? They say nothing. But wait a minute. This is important evidence. So where'd that come from? Thermite is so hot that it'll just cut through steel, through structural steel, for example, like a knife through butter. The products are molten iron and aluminum oxide, which goes off primarily as a dust. You know those enormous dust clouds? You can imagine when you assemble these chemicals on a large scale. Molten metal pools under both towers after they collapsed and Building 7. Now, Building 7 wasn't even hit by a jet.
Part of the problem is that most people simply don't know much about Building 7 due to the extraordinary secrecy surrounding this collapse.
And this was a 47-story skyscraper. This building fell at 5:25.
It was not hit by a plane. This building had fires on only 2 or 3 floors.
And it was brought down by what we know was a controlled demolition.
Demolitions, they look just like that. You know, a kink in the middle, and then that building just comes straight down, almost at free fall speed.
They first blow one of the central columns so the building falls in on itself. Building 7 had a classic crimp, or wedge. Its central column was blown out first, so it didn't structurally damage buildings just a few feet away from it.
Our office was on the B1 level. As I was talking to a supervisor at 8:46, and all of a sudden we hear, boom!